And present his case study on the constituent processes and the role of state powers in the transitions in North Africa. In the 3 years following the Arab Spring, North African countries have engaged in constitutional drafting processes. Some states amended their existing constitution, others put in place a new one. Egypt and Tunisia both adopted a new constitution in January this year. Libya is still struggling to adopt its own basic law amid a deteriorating security situation. Morocco took a different path and prudently preferred to begin a process of reform to diffuse the risks of political rupture. In Algeria, the president undertook in 2011 to introduce amendments to the constitution to strengthen democracy. He set up a constitutional commission in April 2013 in charge of making proposals. The commission submitted its conclusion in September last year, but since then there has been no follow-up. The adoption of a constitution has been considered as a central element to lay down the foundations for democratic governance and to end revolutionary conflicts. A constitution, indeed, is a social contract which binds all sectors of society together. It establishes the nature of the political system, its identity, the rules of the political game, and determines the fundamental principles according to which the state will be governed. A new constitution can help a country along a path to national reconciliation in the wake of a crisis or exceptional circumstances of some sort. The constitution building processes in North Africa, all of them with their own specificities, have been at the center of a struggle for power between executive, legislative, judicial powers, Islamist and religious institutions, secular political parties, and even the military, at least in Egypt. And the constitution has become a ball tossed in the political game. I will try to summarize and make a comparison between all these processes, and since two other speakers will focus in their presentations on Tunisia and Morocco, I will develop more the Egyptian constitutional transition in more depth, also because it was a more complex process. So each of these North African states has followed a different path. Some decided to elect the members of the constituent body, while others opted for their appointment by the executive power. Tunisia followed the more democratic process, since its new constitution was drafted by a constituent assembly directly elected by the people. The assembly also worked as a parliament, enjoying both legislative and constitutional powers. In Libya, the constitutional declaration adopted by the National Transitional Council in August 2011 entrusted a constituent assembly appointed by the General National Congress with the drafting of a constitution. Under pressure from the opposition, however, it was decided in July 2012 to elect rather than appoint the constituent assembly. The elections took place in February this year with a very low turnout. Amazigh decided to boycott the elections to contest their being allocated only two seats. And for security reasons, voting could not take place in about 80 polling stations. And as you know, chaos in the country has even deepened since last week, after the Constitutional Court declared the House of Representatives, elected in June, to be dissolved. But the House of Representatives rejected the ruling, saying it had been taken under the threat of arms. And there is now even more pressure on the Constituent Assembly to adopt an interim national constitution as soon as possible to define presidential and parliamentary powers. In Egypt, the constitution of 2012 was the first one to be drafted by an elected body. previous basic laws had all been written by committees appointed by the executive power. The March 2011 Constitutional Declaration, adopted by the Supreme Council of the Armed Forces, stipulated that the new constitution would be drafted by 100 members chosen by the parliament. The newly elected parliament, dominated by Islamists, nominated the members of the Constituent Assembly in March 2012. 1 month later, however, in April, the Constituent Assembly was declared unconstitutional by the State Council because half of its members had been chosen within the Legislative Assembly. A second assembly was elected in June. Out of its 100 members, at least 60 were Islamists. Most non-Islamist members withdrew from the assembly to complain against the way preparatory works were conducted. The law organizing that second constituent assembly was declared unconstitutional by the Supreme Constitutional Court, this time in June 2013, meaning 6 months after the constitution was adopted and entered into force. However, the Supreme Constitutional Court declared that the validity of the constitution will not be challenged due to its approval by the people in a referendum. In both Egypt and Tunisia, it was the first time Islamist parties were offered the opportunity to participate in the drafting of a constitutional text and to set down their vision of society. Their acceptance of the supremacy of a higher state norm binding on all legal and political bodies should be underlined, since in classical Islamic law, you don't have the concept of constitution. Law can only be the expression of the will of God, and the norms are established in mosques by scholars and not in parliaments by elected representatives of the people. So the mere fact that Islamist groups agreed to become political parties and run in elections, to sit in elected legislative and constitutional assemblies, demonstrates their readiness to adapt to the new realities. The constitution of the new Egyptian constitution of 2012 did indeed include more provisions referring to Islam and religion than previously. However, it granted sovereignty to the people alone in Article 5 and granted the political system on the principles of democracy and consultation, a constitution that was drafted by Islamist parties. And in Tunisia, Ennahda ended making important concessions regarding the status of Sharia and Islam, and the constitution was adopted on the basis of a wide national consensus. So participation of Islamic parties in democratic processes, therefore, could end in moderating their ideologies and behavior. In Morocco, the king succeeded in avoiding the escalation of protest to revolution by passing reforms while retaining control of the entire revision process. Shortly after the onset of demonstration in March 2011, the king took the initiative of revising the constitution and unilaterally appointed the members of the reform commission in charge of preparing a draft on the basis of the lines of reform he established. This constitutional reform diminished the powers of the king to the benefit of the government and the parliament, yet the reform has not affected the core of the king's powers, who remains the true holder of power. The king succeeded, though, in diffusing protest movement by following an alternative route towards democratic transition. In Egypt, after the constitution of 2012 was suspended in July 2013, following the removal of the President Mohamed Morsi by the army, a very innovative but not successful two-step process was established to draft a new constitution. or rather to amend the Constitution of 2012. A committee of 10 legal experts was nominated by interim president Hadi Mansour and was given a month-long period to prepare amendments to the Constitution of 2012 and then to pass them on to the committee of 50, to a committee of 50. These 10 experts were 6 judges and 4 constitutional law professors from Egyptian universities. In practice, however, the Committee of 50 did not show any deference to the work of the 10 experts and disregarded their recommendations. This Committee of 50 members, in charge of preparing the final draft amendments, was to reflect the major components of society. The members were selected by the interim president on the basis of opaque criteria, and more than two-thirds of the seats were allocated to representatives of various institutions within the state apparatus, the army, the police, El Azhar, national councils, or were close to the state. Leftist and Nasserist groups were represented by 11 members. Only 2 seats were allocated to political Islam, one for a Salafist from the Noor party and the other one for a former member of the Muslim Brotherhood who had resigned from the group the year before. The prejudice against the representation of Islamists in that committee echoed the sidelinist of secularists, liberals and leftists from the drafting process of the 2012 Constitution. 5 women were appointed in that committee against 7 in the 2012 Constituent Assembly. The new constitution enshrines autonomy for the military, which had already been granted a privileged position by the Constitution of 2012. Its budget will not be made public and will not be under parliamentary monitoring. Civilians can be brought before military courts, and the Minister of Defense will have to be drawn from the officer class, and for 2 presidential terms, meaning 8 years, he also has to be approved by the Supreme Council of the Armed Forces. The judiciary also managed to enshrine considerable autonomy in the new constitution. Judges will be able to govern their own affairs, appoint their own members, select their own leaders, free from any control from the executive and legislative powers. In Egypt, the army acted at least twice as a direct constituent body. In March 2011, after the removal of Mubarak, the Supreme Council of the Armed Forces adopted a constitutional declaration to replace the constitution of 1971 that had been suspended. This document was drafted in secret by anonymous and unaccountable figures, and it was not submitted to referendum by the people, although 10 days before, constitutional amendments to the 1971 constitution had been adopted by referendum. This constitutional declaration was amended by the army in June 2012 to increase its powers, and then it was amended again 2 months later by the newly elected President Mohamed Morsi in August 2012 to abrogate the army's amendment and adopt new ones to increase his own powers. After the constitution of 2012 was suspended following Morsi's removal, interim President Hadi Mansour, appointed by the army, adopted a constitutional declaration on the 8th of July 2013. This document was also drafted in secret and was not submitted to referendum either. As to the constitution of 2014 and even the constitution of 2012, if they were not drafted by the army directly, they were written under its close supervision. The military command, represented by 2 members in the Constituent Assembly of 2012 and by 1 member in the Committee of 50, played a central role in the constitution writing process. So in conclusion, while it is too soon to determine the outcome of the transition processes in countries such as Egypt, Tunisia, and even Morocco, one can compare the current situation in the two countries which adopted a new constitution in January this year. Tunisia held successfully its parliamentary elections a few days ago, while in Egypt, there is a dramatic reverse of the gains made following the January 25th uprising. The human rights provisions of the new constitution are violated in the name of the fight against terrorism. And the parliamentary elections that, according to the constitution, should have taken place before last June are not scheduled before next March. So there is no perfect and unique constitution drafting process. Constitutions drafted under the control of the legislative power, like Tunisia, or executive power, like Morocco, may be successful as long as they are considered as basic laws for all citizens. Egypt failed to build a political consensus. The processes were not inclusive, since in 2012 and 2014, a major faction of society was left out. Both documents were used by dominant groups to extend their advantage over their rivals and reinforce their own position in the state. They were motivated by a desire to protect narrow interests rather than to establish rules to regulate the entire political system and achieve democracy in the future. It was conceived as a short-term political bargain that involved only the most powerful players. Although a constitution should be a compromise document, the product of a negotiation that reflects the interests and powers of the different actors around the shape a given society should take. Otherwise, it will deepen political divides and become an instrument of power rather than a social contract binding all sectors of society together. Thank you.